My secrets are of the grave and must be kept. And this is how I sometimes think of myself, as a great explorer who has discovered some extraordinary land from which he can never return to give his knowledge to the world. But the name of this land is hell. It is not Mexico, of course, but in the heart.
I just couldn't see any way for Malcolm to go out except the way he did. So apparently he drowned in his own vomit. And I don't see anything wrong with that. I think it's quite in fitting, in keeping with the way Malcolm lived.
I don't know now whether it was suicide or what.
I don't think anybody found out, did
they? No, I don't think so, no. I think it was tablets and gin.
No. Heart.
Heart?
Heart failure, yes. Sudden or choking, I don't know which. No, heart failure, I think.
I understand then, Doctor.
On the 4th of July, 1957, an inquest into the death of Malcolm Lowry, a writer by profession, was convened in a coroner's courtroom near the village of Ripe in the south of England. A key witness was his landlady.
She said there was a question of suicide, taking his life, because a bottle of sleeping pills was quite empty. Well, of course, poor old Marjorie may have been taking them. And when the, I suppose, inquest man, whatever he was, he kept harking back on those. Can you tell me anything about those pills? I said, no, I can't. I know nothing, very little about their private life, certainly not about their pills. You must ask Marjorie.
The widow, Marjorie, had been terrified that the great national newspapers would descend on the village courtroom and broadcast to the world the sordid details of a great writer's death.
Thank you, Doctor.
After all, the Times of London itself had once called him a genius. In fact, only a single reporter from the local paper was on hand to record the event. And to the local reporter, Lowry was merely a gin-soaked hack who had abused his wife, swallowed 50 tablets of sodium amytal, eaten a few bites of food, and dropped dead. He was known to have had a compulsion to stuff things in his mouth indiscriminately. And so the coroner's jury decided that Malcolm Lowry had not committed suicide, but had merely suffered death by misadventure.
Towards evening, the rector, who was an old saint, the rector here, came in and said, I've just come to tell you it's all right. I can give him burial in the churchyard.
Years earlier, Malcolm Lowry had written his own epitaph.
Malcolm Lowry, late of the Bowery, his prose was flowery and often glowery. He lived nightly and drank daily and died playing the ukulele.
Only 7 persons attended the funeral, and afterwards an occasional friend would come to pay his respects. Perhaps Malcolm Lowry had really died 10 years earlier, when he had laid his innermost feelings out for everyone to study in a book called Under the Volcano.
He told me he was doomed. I believed him. But the suffering he had to go through in order to produce the volcano, that's the thing that simply as a human being makes one wonder whether the game's worth the candle. I'd rather have the game and the candle. And so far managed it. But Malcolm was one of these people doomed, as he said. He had to choose the one or the other. He chose, he was completely consistent. In a certain sense, he knew what he was about. And he chose to live as he did, and he produced the volcano. I chose to live in a different way, and I didn't produce anything much.
Well, that's not true. You produced a lot.
Well, yes, but I'm still alive. That's a big difference, you know. He's dead.
Lowry began to write the novel, which both destroyed him and made him into a legend, Under the Shadow of the Mexican Volcano, Popocatépetl. In the book, he compressed his entire experience into a single day. November 2nd, 1938, the Mexican Day of the Dead.
I think I know a good deal about physical suffering, but this is worst of all, to feel your soul dying. I wonder if it is because tonight my soul has really died that I feel, at the moment, something like peace. Or is it because right through hell there is a path, and though I may not take it sometimes lately in dreams, I have been able to see it.
Suddenly from outside, a bell spoke out, then ceased abruptly. Dolente, dolore. Over the town in the dark, tempestuous night, backwards revolved the luminous wheel.
Malcolm Lowry was born in 1909 near Liverpool in the north of England. His father was a wealthy cotton merchant. He was the youngest of four sons. The front lawn was 5 acres in size and contained a tennis court and a small golf course. There was a maid, a cook, and a nanny, but Lowry always complained that his mother neglected him. His closest companion was his brother Russell.
Mother I didn't like at all. None of us did. This is not a nice thing to say, but she was, she finally defeated all four of us. And this is 100% not a very nice thing to do. But in the early stages, we were a very happy family. So that I would say that we started off on a good affectionate domestic basis, but it gradually tapered away, I'm afraid. To come back again in the end with the old man, he meant well. But he was just a Victorian father.
How do you think that he saw the boys?
This I don't know. He used to say, of course I've got plans for all my boys, but he never said what they were.
His father was a compulsive bodybuilder who had won a medal for life-saving in the icy waters of the Dee and had once been declared the best developed man in England. The boys were expected to follow his example. At 15, young Malcolm won the junior championship at the famed Royal Liverpool Golf Club at Hoy Lake. To all external appearances, he was a healthy upper-middle-class English lad. He later claimed that he was brutally beaten and half-drowned by cruel nannies and was crippled and blind. This appears to have been somewhat exaggerated.
He got ulcers on his eyes, on his corneal ulcer. There were painful, like stars on the inside. We had to put drops in his eyes. He had this trouble for some time. And eventually, father took him down to London, where he saw a Dr. Hudson, or Mr. Hudson, I suppose, who was an eminent oculist, who scraped Malcolm's eyes with a razor blade. Sounds pretty grim. And cleaned them up. And that was the end of that.
In due course, he was packed off to the inevitable public school. It was the Lees, a school made famous in the novel Goodbye, Mr. Chips. But even that lovable old schoolmaster failed to inspire young Malcolm.
Academically, he was average. He was very good looking. All the Lowry boys were very good looking. He didn't pay much attention to dress. In fact, probably tried to be as unusual as school regulations would allow. And tended rather to possibly slouch a little about the place.
After I've said grace, there'll be one or two notices, and the meal won't be served until after those. Benedictus Benedicat.
Will Julian Jones please see the sister after lunch? The sixth form O and A level candidates. Barker, Clough, Hart, Hocking, Lees.
And Lowry, who was now muscle bound, chronically constipated, had very small hands which he hated, and was a figure of fun on bath nights because of his tiny penis. He was a sports reporter for the school magazine and wrote songs for school concerts with a scrawny young classmate named Ronnie Hill.
Why I'm pining, shady trees, buzzing bees, here comes the break. Yes, I've said so long to everything Chinese. I left my girl in Shanghai, said she'd marry me, my. But as I knew the things she'd do, it's bye-bye, old Shanghai. And we did this one song in particular. I don't know what it was all about. It was called Hindu Babe. And while we did the, he loved doing this one, and it was the one which had a little lot of little breaks, sort of Hindu babe, I love you, love you, love you, very jazzy. And he used to do, used to put a fart in. And so you would go, Hindu babe, I love you, fart, love you, fart, love you. I mean, nobody else in the world could do it.
Can you play it with the farts in?
No, I can't. I can't do it.
Give it to me.
Da, 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 mm. And where I'm umming is where the fart comes. But it was great talent.
At 17, Malcolm was delivered in the family limousine to the Liverpool dockside. Reporters were on hand to witness the event. The little rich boy was shipping out to the China Seas. His 6 months as a deckhand would be largely spent serving tea. But it also fed an imagination that would one day transform that voyage into literature.
He remembered his freighter with a cargo of animals. There had been not only lions, but elephants, tigers, jaguars, all bound for a zoo. The panthers died. In the Indian Ocean at night, the lions roared, the elephants trumpeted and vomited so that none save the carpenter dared go forward. When they smashed into the hurricane, the jaguars moaned in terror like frightened children. No forest had ever plunged so deeply in the long, bending winds as that ship. Bells of Cambridge, whose fountains in moonlight enclosed courts and cloisters, whose enduring beauty in its virtuous remote self-assurance seemed part less of the loud mosaic of one's stupid life there than the strange dream of some old monk 800 years dead. A dream jealously guarded. Keep off the grass. And yet, whose unearthly beauty compelled one to say, God forgive me.
In 1929, Lowry had been enrolled at St. Catherine's College, Cambridge.
I was sitting up reading Plato in his bungalow, and suddenly he appeared. Came up with this rolling gait of seamen, wearing what had once been a very good well-cut suit. It was no longer that. He was carrying a kind of hold-all and a ukulele. We introduced each other. I said, I have bought some drink. He said, so have I. And he produced half a bottle of rum. So we settled down. Within 5 minutes, he was lying underneath the table, strumming his ukulele.
He became a member of Charlotte Haldane's fast literary set. Armed with a ukulele and a regular injection of his father's money, he was seldom seen at the university. He had, as he said, better things to do. The last man to see the student alive had been his fellow undergraduate, Malcolm Lowry. Lowry testified under oath that his friend had been depressed by an accumulation of gambling debts. Years later, he told the truth to his psychiatrist.
His fellow undergraduate had tried to have a homosexual relationship with him. Malcolm Lowry thought this was extremely funny. He thought it was a great joke. And when the young man said that if this were not possible, he would commit suicide, Malcolm Lowry told me, at any rate, that he said, that's a good idea. Why don't you go ahead? And you'll be probably much happier and better off there than here. And next morning, the young man was found to have committed suicide. Now, this haunted him for the rest of his days.
Paradise Street in Liverpool also haunted him for the rest of his days. He had been taken there when he was 5 years old and given a tour of the Syphilis Museum.
Pay attention to your trouser button and see him, if you will, for yourself, the syphilitic, as he strolls aimfully down Great Homer Street. Look how everyone he touches is smitten with a dire disease. It is just that one little word, the word that kills. This is he, the human husk, the leaf of ash, ashes to ashes, and dust to dust.
The college musical that year was Laughing at Love, and it featured Malcolm Lowry as a cabaret artist. He was also writing a novel and short stories for a college literary magazine, edited by Hugh Sykes Davis.
Malcolm was interesting and valuable to us as editors, and we were, I imagine, his first publishers, you see. We published stuff of his, above all because he wrote in prose. Now, at that time, poetry was the fashionable thing. The notion that you could write creative and imaginative prose was just there because Joyce was in the background, you see. We knew about all that. But mostly, our contributors wrote stream-of-consciousness stuff of an unutterable boredom. I cannot describe how shattering... But Malcolm came along doing the same kind of thing. But his stuff was different. I still remember reading a script of his in this rather odd typewriting, you know, that naturally resulted. My first murder was committed in a windmill. Well, I must say, that riveted my attention, you know, and I said, we ought to publish this stuff, and we did.
After a furious burst of academic application, Lowry managed to gain an English Tripos degree, third class. He also finished his novel, Ultramarine. Of it, the Times of London said, if the art of writing is imitation, the author has mastered it. Nevertheless, it was good enough to get published, and Lowry was a young man of accomplishment. There is no evidence that his mother ever read the book. Lowry had been seeing less and less of his family, but he did return for his 21st birthday.
Well, Father raised his glass and we drank Malcolm's health. And then He cleared his throat and said, well, Malcolm, what's your first recollection, you know? I think I was sitting on your dead knee, Daddy. I wanted, was the desire to dance. And Malcolm, as I said, looked across at me and frowned, and then he looked up at the ceiling and said, as far as I can remember, my childhood was one of perpetual gloom. I was either blind, constipated, or a cripple. And, well, this didn't warm things up very much. He was obviously trying to be unpleasant, wasn't he?
From the age of 25, he never saw a blood relative again. One of his last visits was to his sister-in-law.
And then he called on me shortly after we were married, studiedly picturesque again, wearing an Alfred Holt jersey, across a very impressive chest indeed. I can't remember anything about his the rest of his attire, but shall we say it was negligee, to say the least. And he talked very sweetly for a short time, and then said, oh, well, I see you've got a garden. One day I too will have a garden, and I will grow nothing in it but mushrooms. Goodbye. And he left, and I never met him again.
Lowry left the genteel life forever. Now he was in London, Paris, and Spain. His father sent him 6 guineas a week, his mother sent him the British Weekly, and he shared his frequent hangovers with old pals from Cambridge, like Martin Case.
He and I were walking along a street not far from the Fitzroy Tavern one afternoon, and in those days there were still horses and carts to be seen in the streets of London. Well, we were just passing a horse in a cart, and the horse, I don't think I could do it for you, but I don't know whether you know the kind of, no, I can't do it, noise that they make with their lips. And this horse made this in Malcolm's ear as we passed. Malcolm, without thinking, he just automatically thought, damn it, the thing was jeering at me, came round with his fist, about 6 inches, that was all, and the horse fell to its knees, so practically knocked out.
Knocked out a horse with one punch.
Yes, and a very short punch at that. And he was terribly distressed about it because he was the kindest soul and loved animals. He thought, my God, I've caused some distress to this horse. What am I to do? And it was weeks before he forgot about it and stopped talking about it. Of course, the horse wasn't hurt at all. It picked itself up in no time.
It isn't a question of being drunk from time to time. That's normal. That happens to a lot of good citizens and ordinary people. Point was with him and with his friend John Davenport from across this yard, how rarely they were totally sober. It couldn't have amounted to more than an hour or two a month, you see. And it's this persistent drinking, not so that he was ever quarrelsome. He was always very gentle, delicate, polite. They didn't get like that, but they got used to being tight.
But other friends were beginning to notice a strangeness in Lowry, which could not be explained by booze.
And he said, you know, they put a male nurse on me to shadow me. And we said, what do you mean? He said he was there this afternoon. We said, where? He said, out in Torbay. In the middle of Torbay, I turned over on my back to float, and there he was, swimming towards me. Well, we said, where is he now? Oh, he said, he's gone. He's like that. He just appears and he disappears. And that was really the first time that one came to be a little speculative about him, you know?
He had had little to do with women. Now in Spain, he met a beautiful American writer named Jan Gabriel and fell in love.
Oh, he was rather like a rather little boy, rather shy and bubbling, you know, and rather anxious to show off his new possession to the best effect. So all this is very charming, actually, very sweet, both of them.
They were married in 1934, but a few months later, Lowry was on the Queen Mary, steaming towards New York, to try to find his wife. Jan Gabriel had fled her new husband. Now he was in New York, a city he described as having an existential fury, and there was little to distinguish him from the other helpless children of the streets. He found his wife and they were together spasmodically, but Jan Gabriel now realized that what he wanted was not a wife, but a mother.
I think that she was terribly distraught by his drinking and also by the fact that fags were on his tail, you should forgive the expression.
At one point, Malcolm had one of his choking attacks and threw himself on the ground on his stomach, asking me to bang him on the back, which I did till he began to recover. We finally reached the inn, but instead of going to my room, we went to Nancy's because it was bigger. We locked the door and went to bed together. He was very affectionate, much kissing, but nothing else really. He was not capable of it, probably due to the drink or possibly he was impotent. About noon, there was a knock on the door. I called out, "Can't you understand when two men want to be alone together?" And they went away.
He awakened one morning, not knowing if a sexual act had taken place between himself and a man who was after him. But he was worried about whether he had contracted a venereal disease, and he asked me if I knew a doctor.
His deepening sense of sin and guilt went far beyond the occasional homosexual indiscretion. It seemed to penetrate every corner of his being. Drink helped to appease the demons, but he sensed that there was only one way they could be truly exorcised. He could write them to death.
He goes into another saloon. From this he emerges, cunningly repaired. Again, the pilgrimage starts. Perhaps like the poor cat who had lost an eye in a battle, he is just looking for his sight. Near him, arrogant, bearded derelicts cringe over spittoons. And of these men, he seems afraid. He wanders from saloon to saloon as though searching for something, but always keeping the hospital in sight. Once he stops in a church, his lips moving in something like a prayer. Inside, it is cool. Around the walls are pictured the stages of the cross. Nobody seems to be looking. He likes drinking in churches particularly, but afterwards he comes to a place not like a church at all. This is the hospital. All day he has hovered around it. Now it looms up closer than ever. Tilting the bottle to his mouth, he takes a long, final draught. With the dithering crack of a ship going on the rocks, the door shuts behind him.
How do you know? You're not signing your name. How come you don't sign your name when you go to work? Don't you know? Don't you know your name? I know my name. I know.
An almost incoherent Malcolm Lowry had been committed to the Bellevue Psychiatric Hospital. Here was a place that took cases no one else would touch.
How do you you know you're there? You're not signing your name? I know.
Up to now, he had been merely a poseur, playing with ideas of madness and oblivion. But this was no longer the rich bourgeois world where one fell about on soft grass. Here were minds that were really rotted by alcohol, syphilis, hopelessness. Here were things that kept on living, despite the fact they were beyond repair.
Keys clashed like cymbals. The bathroom door banged open. The daily routine was beginning. Presently, the rooms were filled with the dreadful noise of shuffling feet. Watching them, he gradually thought he understood the meaning of death. Not as a sudden dispatch of violence, but as a function of life.
After 3 weeks of confinement, the immigration authorities began to take notice of Lowry. It was possible he would be deported as an alien madman. He fled the hospital in terror.
Outside, he felt no sense of release, only inquietude. He kept gazing back with a sort of longing at the building that had been his home. Returning to the saloon, he picked out a secluded place to sit where they brought his whiskey. But feeling he was being watched even there, he moved later, drink in hand, to the very obscurest corner of the bar, where, curled up like an embryo, he could not be seen at all.
And yet Malcolm Lowry would begin his great book with the words of Sophocles, "Wonders are many, and none is more wonderful than man." On the Day of the Dead, November 2nd, 1936, Mr. and Mrs. Malcolm Lowry arrived in Mexico. Lowry was 27 years of age. His passport described him as a writer, but he considered his only book an embarrassment. His life, in fact, was an embarrassment.
He looked at the sun, but he had lost the sun. It was not his son. Like the truth, it was well nigh impossible to face. He did not want to go anywhere near it, least of all sit in its light facing it.
Jan Gabriel was not spending too much time with Malcolm Lowry. She was sure she had married a genius, but that genius seemed largely bent on self-destruction. At any rate, they settled in a small house on the Calle Humboldt. The street sat on the edge of a barranca, a deep ravine that served as an open sewer. For Lowry, this became a mystical symbol, as did the twin volcanoes, Popocatépetl and Ixtaquihuatl, that sat on the horizon. Here he began to write a story he called Under the Volcano.
He lay back in his chair. Ixtaquihuatl and Popocatépetl, that image of the perfect marriage, lay now clear and beautiful on the horizon under an almost pure morning sky. Far above him, a few white clouds were racing windily after a pale, gibbous moon. "Drink all morning," they said to him. "Drink all day. This is life." Enormously high, too, he noticed some vultures waiting, more graceful than eagles, as they hovered there like burnt papers floating from a fire. The
The shadow of an immense weariness stole over him. The consul fell asleep with a crash.
Gradually, a creature that Lowry called simply the consul began to emerge. Miraculously, for he was still drinking as heavily as ever, and his marriage was in shreds, Lowry began to write as he had never written before. Perhaps this was his last hope, the justification and redemption of his largely worthless life. For the consul, who drinks mezcal down to the worm, is not a creature of fiction at all, but Malcolm Lowry himself.
Oozing alcohol from every pore, the consul stood at the open door of the Salon Ophelia. How sensible to have had a mezcal, how sensible. For it was the right, the sole drink to have under the circumstances. Moreover, he had not only proved to himself he was not afraid of it, he was now fully awake, fully sober again, and well able to cope with anything that might come his way. But for this slight continual twitching and hopping within his field of vision as of innumerable sand fleas, he might have told himself he hadn't had a drink for months. The only thing wrong with him, he was too hot.
Lowry was writing about a defrocked British diplomat in the final stages of alcoholic disintegration. He was also writing, sometimes with good humor, about hell.
But look here, hang it all, it is not altogether darkness. You misunderstand me if you think it is altogether darkness, I see. And if you insist on thinking so, how can I tell you why I do it? But if you look at that sunlight there, then perhaps you'll get the answer. See, look. Look at the way it falls through the window. What beauty can compare to that of a cantina in the early morning? Not even the gates of heaven opening wide to receive me could fill me with such celestial, complicated, and hopeless joy as the iron screen that rolls up with a crash.
I never saw him without sex, you know, as he wrote in his book.
All mystery, all hope, all disappointment, yes, all disaster is here beyond those swinging doors. And by the way, do you see that old woman from Tarasco's sitting in the corner? How, unless you drink as I do, can you hope to understand the beauty of an old woman from Tarasco who plays dominoes at 7 o'clock in the morning? Ah, a woman could not know the perils, the complications, yes, the importance of a drunkard's life.
And then we went on the town, and one drink became five, became ten. You know, little computers.
Lowry's old friend and fellow writer, Arthur Calder Marshall, brought his wife to Mexico to meet Malcolm.
And I think it was, what, 3 days later, that we were rung before breakfast and told by Jan that Mark hadn't come home. She said, I don't care about him, but he's taken the alarm clock out and he's drinking the alarm clock, and I'll have to go into Mexico City to get another alarm clock, and I cannot stand that. And when Jan said, but why did you take the alarm clock? Mark said, how should I know when not to stop working without an alarm clock?
The consul, an inconceivable anguish of horripilating hangover, thunderclapping about his skull and accompanied by a protective screen of demons nattering in his ears, became aware that in the horrid event of his being observed by his neighbors, it could hardly be supposed he was just sauntering down his garden with some innocent horticultural object in view. Not even that he was sauntering. In vain, he tried to check himself, plunging his hands with an extraordinary attempt at nonchalance, in which he hoped might appear more than a hint of consular majesty, deeper into the sweat-soaked pockets of his dress trousers.
The day before him stretched out like an illimitable, rolling, wonderful desert in which one was going, though in a delightful way, to be lost. And where now he was drawn on beautifully by the dissolving mirages, past the skeletons like frozen wire, and the wandering, dreaming lions, towards ineluctable personal disaster. Always in a delightful way, of course.
She had a story she told us that night about his courtship in Granada. And she said that one evening he took her for a walk in the garden of the Generalife. And now he suddenly fell on top of her.
He lurched.
And lay on top of her, and she was ready for a fate not worse than death. And he then told her the plot of Ultramarine from beginning to end, and they then went home.
I think she was very fond of him. I don't think, physically, it was all their cop, because, he got so drunk that I think she was a bit worried. I think it might have been, drink made him a bit impotent. She never actually said that, but one could gather it. Otherwise, why did she hop off with, various chaps?
If Jan Gabriel hopped off with various chaps, she had good reason. Lowry sometimes seemed to throw her at other men. And so he applied his talent to yet another facet of himself, the cuckolded husband.
Was it here he had been betrayed? This very room, perhaps, had been filled with her cries of love. But the abominable impact on his whole being at this moment of the fact that that hideously elongated, cucumiform bundle of blue nerves and gills below the steaming, unself-conscious stomach had sought its pleasure in his wife's body brought him trembling to his feet. How loathsome, how incredibly loathsome was reality. It won't be long before he realizes he's only one of the hundred or so other ninnyhammers with gills like codfish and veins like racehorses, prime as goats, all of them hot as monkeys, salt as wolves in pride. What an uncommon time you two must have had, paddling palms and playing boobies and titties all day under cover of saving me. Jesus, poor little defenseless me. I've got my own piddling little fight for freedom on my hands. Mommy, let me go back to that beautiful brothel. God, is it possible to suffer more than this? Out of this suffering, something must be born. And what would be born was his own death. For, how alike are the groans of love to those of the dying. How alike those of love to those of the dying.
Jan Gabriel finally ran off forever with a man from Santa Barbara. And Lowry was left alone in a town he described as having 400 swimming pools, 18 churches, and 57 cantinas, those small Mexican drinking places, which did not open until noon.
Now, where I worked, found Lowry was in a damn grocery store, because at that time, one didn't go to cantinas either. I mean, it was just too expensive for me. And at that 9 o'clock in the morning, the cantinas weren't open. And these grocery stores were sort of clandestine places, So I think he found it beautiful here because all alcoholics look for the hell, and when they find it, this is the place to go. Why go further?
Mexico itself.
Well, I think he personally found his place there at that time.
I mean, you sort of search out a place which will become your private hell.
The crummiest, You find this crummy place, and that's it. Why now? I've found it. I'm in hell. What more can God give me,
The entire landscape for Lowry was now monstrous. and even letters to his friends were more like cries from the heart.
To John Davenport, 1936. No words exist to describe the terrible condition I am in. I have, since being here, been in prison 3 times. Everywhere I go, I am pursued, and even now, as I write, no less than 5 policemen are watching me. For obvious and oblivious reasons, I cannot write to my family. For reasons so obvious that they're almost naked, I may not write to my wife. I looked around in the black recesses of what used to be a mine and saw 2 friends, yourself and Arthur Calder Marshall. I also saw something else, not so friendly. Imminent insanity. Another complication is that never in my whole life have I been to a place so fantastically beautiful as this. And in spite of it all, it would be difficult for me to leave. The people are lovely, gentle, polite, passionate, profound, and true. Like Columbus, I've torn through one reality and discovered another. But like Columbus also, I thought Cuba was on the mainland, and it was not. And like Columbus also, it is possible I'm leaving a heritage of destruction. I'm not at all sure about this, but in a Mexican prison you have to drink out of the piss pot sometimes, especially when you have no passport. Part of this, of course, is imaginary as usual, but for once it is not as imaginary as usual. In fact, danger both to mind and body threatens from all sides. This is not the cry of the boy who cried wolf. It is the wolf itself who cries for help. It is impossible to say that this is less of a cry than a howl. What is impossible is to eat, sleep, work, and I fear it may rapidly be becoming impossible also to live. I cannot even remotely imagine that I'm writing these terrible words. But here I am, and outside is the sun, and inside, God only knows, and he has already refused. I cannot see Jan now, but for God's sake, see she's all right. I foresaw my fate too deeply to involve her in it.
In the summer of 1938, Malcolm Lowry left Mexico under somewhat mysterious circumstances. He had spent at least 1 Christmas in prison, and perhaps he was deported as an undesirable alien. Possibly his father thought young Malcolm should continue his disintegration closer to a Methodist church. Or maybe Lowry made one of his rare independent decisions. At any rate, after 20 months in Mexico, Lowry departed, carrying little with him but an unfinished novel. Lowry was placed by his family in a small Los Angeles hotel. As checks from his father were remitted directly to the hotel management, he was virtually a prisoner. He spent a year expanding his novel. His brothers still worked for the family firm.
Hey, he was a remittance man.
Was there any resentment amongst the family against him for that?
None at all. No. Only he used to write... he was forever making trouble, you know, and there used to be great meetings used to go on for old Stuart to be called into father's office, and we wanted to get in there to get some letters signed, and one couldn't get on with life because Malcolm was in the way. And, Oh, father was paying Malcolm more to stay out of the country than he was paying me to work like a slave in the office.
In August 1939, Lowry's father suddenly ordered his son to head further north. Lowry didn't even bother to pack his manuscript. The move was described as temporary. It would last for 14 years.
Suppose you land in Vancouver. It has a sort of pango-pango quality mingled with sausage and mash and generally a rather Puritan atmosphere. Everyone is fast asleep, and when you prick them, a Union Jack flows out of the hole. But no one, in a certain sense, lives there. They merely, as it were, pass through, mine the country, and quit. Blast the land to pieces, knock down the trees, and send them rolling down Burrard Inlet. As for drinking, by the way, that is beset, everywhere beset, by perhaps favorable difficulties. No bars, only beer parlors, so uncomfortable and cold, that serve beer so weak, no self-respecting drunkard would show his nose in them. You have to drink at home, and when you run short, it's too far to get a bottle.
With the Second World War about to break out, Lowry's father must have thought he would be safer under the British flag, and transferred his allowance to a Vancouver lawyer. Without his manuscript to work on, he tried hard to overcome the difficulties of drinking in the Dominion. On top of everything else, he was once again in love. While in Hollywood, he had been introduced to a former starlet, Marjorie Bonner. It was love at first sight.
And this man got off the bus and walked over and put his arms around me and said, Marjorie, and I said, Malcolm. So by the time Jack King got off the bus to introduce us, there we were standing on the corner of Hollywood and Western with our arms around each other. And that's how we met.
Now she joined him in a small attic room in Vancouver, bringing with her the manuscript of Under the Volcano. The Second World War had broken out. Although Lowry was not enthusiastic, he made a desultory attempt to enlist in the army. He was rejected. He was desperately short of money, and he looked for other sources of revenue. He found one in John Buchan, a fellow writer, now Lord Tweedsmuir, Governor General of Canada.
Well, we were very poor, of course, and Malcolm wrote John Buck and Lord Tweedsmuir as one writer to another to try and help him out. So Lord Tweedsmuir wrote him a very nice letter and sent him a check and an introduction to the editor of the Vancouver Province, I think it was. And Malk wrote a few articles for them. It wasn't easy for him. He wasn't a reporter, but it made us a little money, which helped some.
While Marjorie searched for a cheap country cottage, Lowry reworked his novel from beginning to end. After 10 months, he sent it off to a New York agent.
Dear Malcolm, I have regretfully come to the conclusion that I'm not going to find a publisher for Under the Volcano. It has been rejected by Farrah and Reinhardt, Harcourt Brace, Houghton Mifflin, Alfred Knopp, J.B. Lippincott, Little Brown, Random House, Scribner's, Simon & Schuster, Story Press. I'm sorry that I wasn't successful in placing it for you, and am holding the script here for your instructions.
Dear Hal, I'm sorry I've only given you further disappointment with Under the Volcano so far, and it may be that the adverse conditions under which the book was finally written influenced me to think it was an artistic triumph when it was only a sort of moral one. So I am rewriting it. I think it foolish to embark on an absolutely new project at this time.
Lowry lay in bed for 4 days without eating, sleeping, speaking, or even drinking. Then he rose and looked out at his new surroundings. The Lowrys had moved only 10 miles, but they had escaped the hated city. They now lived in one of the squatter shacks on the shores of Burrard Inlet near the village of Dollarton. Lowry built himself a pier. It was awkward and flimsy, but to everyone's surprise, it withstood the gales and tides, and towards it, Lowry developed a particular affection, this frail thing that could endure the storms of the world.
your refinery, you can see the buildings over there in the distance. There used to be a very large sign in Light's shell, of which the S had been burned out. And so at night, this great huge sign, Hell, would shine through the darkness, through the mist from the refinery, with the flashing lights of the burning, whatever was going on there. And Malcolm very frequently used to refer to that refinery as Hell or the city of Dis. It was always a source of joy to him to look out of this paradise into the civilized part of the world, which for him was Hell.
And one night, Malcolm was looking out of the window and he said, "Oh, twilight, it's such a sad time of day, isn't it?" And I turned to him and I said, "Malcolm, listen to me, look at me. You'll never have to be lonely or sad again. Twilight will be a happy time. We'll pull the curtains and light the lamps and be from the dark night withdrawn together." And oh, he threw his arms around me, and ever after that he insisted on cleaning the lamps and oiling them and filling them and lighting them at twilight. It was a big ceremony.
Unlike Jan Gabriel, Marjorie was willing to function both as a wife and a mother. She watched over her man-child as he stood writing for 12 hours at a stretch, his legs developing varicose veins, his small hands pressed so hard against the table that they developed ape-like pads. If he occasionally fell into a bottle of gin, he would pick himself up in the morning, dredge up the dreadful memories of Mexico, and try again to write it all down.
The band struck up Guadalajara again in the wind, and the bull bellowed, his horns caught in the railing through which, helpless, he was being poked with sticks in what remained of his testicles, tickled with switches, a machete, and after getting clear and re-entangled, a garden rake. Dust, too, and dung was thrown in his red eyes, and now there seemed no end to this childish cruelty. Mexico was not laughing away her tragic history. Mexico was bored. The bull was bored. Everyone was bored. Perhaps had been all the time. As, amid boredom, the bull circled the arena, and, boredom, he now finally sat down in a corner of it. It was a tiresome and odious spectacle, really. The only people happy were the drunks. Gripping tequila or mezcal bottles, they tottered into the ring. Yes, it struck her now that this whole business of the bull was like a life. The important birth, the fair chance, the tentative, then assured, then half-despairing circulation of the ring, an obstacle negotiated, a feat improperly recognized, boredom, resignation, collapse. Then another, more convulsive birth, a new start, the circumspect endeavors to obtain one's bearings in a world now frankly hostile, followed by disaster, capitulation, disintegration.
Yes, then when he had reached a certain place, the end of a chapter or a scene or something, he would give me the script and I would type it for him. And then I would read it over carefully and write out my comments on it. And then he would read it over and write out his comments on it. And then we would sit down and have a big discussion. And of course, sometimes he would scream and say, "Oh, you cut out the best thing I ever wrote in my life. It's bleeding, it's awful." And then he'd calm down and then he'd read me what he thought about it and I'd say what I thought. And in the end, he'd usually shake his head and say, "Well, you were right. Yes, I went on to a long dissertation. It needs cutting."
On the morning of June 7th, 1944, Lowry's shack burst into flame. Inside was the fourth draft of Under the Volcano.
We didn't get any furniture, anything out. I rescued the volcano.
What was Malcolm's immediate reaction to that? Was it one of
heartbreak, or?
Oh, he went to pieces. He'd stop people on the street for a year afterwards and say, my house burnt down. Do you realize my house burnt down? He was in terrible shape. Even when we were in Haiti, he was stopping people and saying, my house burnt down. He went into a state of shock.
Lowry would return to rebuild his shack, but now he took his charred manuscript to Niagara-on-the-Lake, where he worked through the winter. On the 6th of June, 1945, after 8 years of writing, he once again sent his manuscript to a New York agent.
Of course, it may not be any good at all. 5 years ago, I deceived myself into thinking I'd pull it off, as of course I had not done. However, I feel now it may be a pretty good job, and myself justified in sending it to you, since my impression is that the majority of its faults in the older version have been done away with.
Now he returned to the volcano itself, and he was afraid. He was always afraid of immigration officers. He was definitely a man to be denounced at borders. He saw himself as a man who had failed at everything. He had failed to support his wife, to fight in wars. He had let his house burn down. Now he was afraid of being taken over by his own fiction. What, he noted in his diary, what if he were coming back to Mexico not to assert his own rejuvenation, but to seek the death that had eluded him there 8 years before? Lowry showed Marjorie the scenes of the novel while he waited with a gathering desperation for some word about his book. He was devastated when a book on alcoholism, The Lost Weekend, became a smash bestseller.
Dear old Conrad, my novel, The Volcano, seems to have gone smack into the void. No intelligent comment so far or encouragement. I think it is really good, though The Lost Weekend may have deprived it of some of its impact. Alack, prosaic justice.
One of the publishers to receive the manuscript was the great British house of Jonathan Cape. These were the people who had published his first novel 13 years before. But they had quite forgotten about Malcolm Lowry.
Now, I'd hate to have the responsibility of reading that novel by an unknown man when that came onto my desk along with 10 other pieces of rubbish. What happened is when originally it was sent in, we got a reader's report on it by a then our resident reader, a man called William Plumer, a poet who died about a year ago. And he wrote a report on the book, and Jonathan Cape sent a copy of the report to Lowry. And he wrote to Lowry and said, I'd like to publish your book. If you undertake to try to correct some of the things pointed out, some of the faults pointed out in this report, we'd definitely guarantee to do it. If you don't, we might still publish it, but I'd be interested in your view. Now, this brought forth perhaps one of the most extraordinary letters, perhaps the greatest letter I've ever seen by an author, which was a full exposition of the meaning and intention of that book.
Dear Mr. Cape, thank you very much indeed for yours of the 29th November, which did not reach me, however, until New Year's Eve.
There are 1,000 writers who can draw adequate characters till all is blue for one who can tell you anything new about hellfire. And I'm telling you something new about hellfire.
Chapter 12.
I have scarcely changed it since 1940, though I made some slight additions and subtractions in 1942 and substituted the passage, quote, how alike are the groans of love to the groans of the dying, end of quote, etc., in 1944 for another one not so good. I do think it deserves in this chapter is an almost biblical one. Hasn't the guy had enough suffering? Surely we've reached the end now. But no, apparently it's only just starting.
When you get to the end, if you have read carefully, you should want to turn back to the beginning again, where it is not impossible, too, that your eye might alight once more upon Sophocles' wonders are many, and none is more wonderful than man, just to cheer you up.
And I may say that Jonathan's answer to that was an immediate offer of a contract.
Dear Mr. Cape, you will have my proof soon. We are wallowing in success, feeling, in fact, like starving men whose eyes are being stuffed with potatoes. Ever sincerely yours, Malcolm Lowry.
The same day, the great American editor, Albert Erskine, who would handle William Faulkner, John O'Hara, and James Michener, decided with his colleagues at Raynal Hitchcock that they would publish the book. On the day of publication, Lowry arrived in New York.
No, it was a cold and ugly day, and everything seemed to be a little bit off key to me for some reason. I don't know whether he'd been drinking already or not. And I went to meet them at the Greyhound bus station. Took them to their hotel.
Did you meet what you
expected? Immediately to the bar.
Did you meet what you expected to meet, or was it a surprise?
It was a surprise.
Now, quavering, they asked, what are the reviews like? And Albert just said, there's never been anything like them, and there never had been. Nobody had ever had such reviews. And it just about knocked him out. He couldn't believe it.
That was the thing that's been told over and over again about Marjorie and me looking for him in bars and finally finding him in one on Lexington, having exhausted Third Avenue. And he walked in while we were there and said, you know, I knew you'd be here.
Were you aware of his drinking propensities before you met him?
I assumed from the book that he had had some experience, but I thought that maybe he'd stopped. The book seems to disapprove of it.
The book was soon out in 15 languages. The Germans called it a masterpiece. The French called it the greatest book since Ulysses. Tokyo's Mainichi Shimbun said, it belongs to the centuries. From the prestigious journals of the English-speaking world came unprecedented critical acclaim.
If there is morbidity here, it is akin to that of Elizabethan tragedy, born of an involved and passionate interest in the secrets of the fall of man. So strong is the light which the author directs on the central character that the shadow it casts is one of tragic dimensions.
I have never before used this word in a review, but I'm of the opinion that Under the Volcano is a work of genius.
Hounded by so many absurd calamities, Lowry bequeathed us many courageous efforts and one magnificent achievement. Under the Volcano may have cost him everything. If so, it was no waste.
And of course everybody wanted to give parties for him, and he just fell apart. He couldn't stand it. He got drunk. He backed against the wall like a treed animal, and just stood there in a sort of stupor and said, how do you do? Yes, thank you. And looked like a trapped animal.
The Lowrys returned to Dollerton, where his peer was still standing. There was some confusion whether he was a British or a Canadian writer, and both sides lay claim to him.
It is rather discouraging very often being a writer in Canada. Somebody put the Volcano in the Encyclopedia Britannica yearbook 1948-49, ranking it as the work of a Canadian over and above anything then current in American literature, but not one word did I ever hear of that here. All I've ever heard was from my royalty report, namely that the sales in Canada from the end of 1947-49 were precisely two copies. The Sun published only a few syndicated lines that called it a turgid novel, full of self-destruction, not for the discerning or something reader.
Lowry was exaggerating. Although he was certainly not a household name in Canada, there was a band of disciples gathering around the resident genius. The Lowry legend began to take shape.
So one night, the liquor was all gone. I guess Malcolm had he was drunk. But he said, now I am going to do to be Christ. I'm going to change water to wine. And he was so convinced, he was very convincing. And he had me convinced during this time that he was able to do this. You see, this is what he was. His charisma was so great that he could really spellbind you. So he went out to the kitchen tap, and he turned the tap on, and he said, "This is wine. Drink it." He gave it to me, and I'll swear it was wine. That was just that was the kind of influence he had on you at that time.
He had you believing you were drinking wine.
Really did. He really had the...
You couldn't swear you weren't. And he believed it, so...
He did, too. This was the whole
thing. He had to, because the only thing there was to drink in the house...
Was water over the tap.
Lowry was supposed to be writing books. They were waiting in London and New York, and Lowry was stalling for time. Among the work in progress was something called October Ferry to Gabriola. Whenever Lowry could stall no longer, it went to New York in fragments.
Malcolm would, I think we had given $3,600 advance, payable $100 a month over 3 years. But it could be cut off if the book didn't seem to be going well. And I knew that as soon as Bob Haas read any of this October Ferry, that the money was going to be cut off, so I didn't tell him I had it. I found it just tedious as anything I've ever read. And coming after the other book, I couldn't understand it.
He was desperately afraid of being a one-shot novelist and tried to keep working. But his publishers finally cut him off.
My dear Albert, I hate to break a long silence in this way, but can you somehow lend us $200 immediately? I was always taught to begin a short story like this. It may interest you to know that there is a long broadcast tonight or tomorrow night on the subject of Malcolm Lowry, Canada's greatest, most successful writer, which we can't listen to because our radio has run down and we can't afford to replenish the battery, the unkindest cut of all.
Gradually, the legend disintegrated. He had become a repulsive drunk. When everything else ran out, he drank aftershave lotion. Earl Burney, the poet, kicked him out. Downey Kirk, the schoolteacher, kicked him out.
Dear Downey, this is a letter of thanks to you and your wife for a wonderful evening, but also a letter of apology, so it's addressed to you alone. Since I do not feel even worthy of addressing your wife at the moment, I am told I used bad language in front of your wife and Dorothy. This is utterly inexcusable, of course. I am deeply sorry. Sincerely, Malcolm.
I've always felt that Marjorie had had enough, and I don't blame her. It was a very cramped little place, and who am I to blame her, for goodness sake? But it was a pretty dead kind of life, and she was a beautiful woman, and lively, and I think she wanted a larger scene, and I think there was such a basic love and trust between them that if she wanted that and wanted it badly enough, he would do what she wanted.
His only friends now were the old originals, Sam the Fisherman, Jimmy Craig, Harvey Burt.
And the last time I saw Malcolm in Vancouver was with old Jim Craig. Old Jim had walked as far down the hallway leading to the plane as he could, and Malcolm turned just before they disappeared through the last door, and he clung to old Jim, and he almost surrounded old Jim, but he just stood there, and it seemed to me the longest time. I heard them say nothing at all, but just that clinging of a child to its last parent, its last support, and then he was whisked away and disappeared, and Jimmy never saw him again.
Success is like some horrible disaster, worse than your house burning. The sounds of ruination as the roof tree falls, following each other faster while you stand, the helpless witness of your damnation. Fame, like a drunkard, consumes the house of the soul, exposing that you have worked for only this. Ah, that I never suffered this treacherous kiss, and had been left in darkness forever to founder and fail.
No. It'll break your heart.
I don't get it. What do you find so sad about it?
Well, the idea of such a talented man going so wrong. I'm sorry to get sentimental, but I always do and I always will. It's a beautiful book. And it's the writing is so tremendous that I would say it compares with Conrad or any of those. But my God, here's a guy that just, he could cope as long as he was drunk. The minute he got sober, he couldn't cope with anything. And it made me sad. He couldn't get his ass into gear.
There were other admirers of Lowry of great academic distinction. 20 years later, there would be 4 full-fledged biographies and 147 doctoral theses dealing with the most arcane aspects of the man and his work.
It's very difficult to date, and I've come across 10 drafts so far, but I would guess that it's...
He could become very frustrated because his determination was short-lived, and we're finding this from his lower loops, which are, you're going to find in Y's and G's, and they're made just barely. And this also...
And it is, in fact, I would say, a precursor of the French Nouveau Roman. And Professor Day, of course, is a professor of comparative literature. I'm not suggesting he doesn't know the Nouveau Roman, but still he has not made this comparison, and I think he ought to do so.
Yes, it's rather fun. We don't get many visitors here in the ordinary course of events because we're rather out the track. But in the summer, people come out from Brighton and Eastbourne, nice place to ride out with the family and walk. And then you get one or two who, you know, have come from a good few thousand miles further sometimes, and you see lurking in the background a sort of PhD thesis that's beginning to form, and I say, aha, Lowry, to myself. And they say to me, Lowry, and I say, yes, and I show them where the grave is. And...
It is the satire, the grotesques. The way that the policeman walks through the novel,
the kind of landscape that he uses in Under the Volcano. I mean, it's physical. It has a sort of physical presence, but at the same time,
the very precise comments on
almost fantasized.
The outside world, the fighting in China, Japan, China, the fighting in the Spanish Civil War. And what he's actually seen is the land exploding. He's seen the volcanoes going off. The volcanoes are dead no longer.
Now he smiled for snapshots in front of monuments and carted with him thousands of pages of work that he was ashamed to show to the rest of the world. Nor was he spared the ultimate emasculation of the writer.
I have now reached a position where every night I write 5 novels in imagination, but am unable to write a word. I cannot explain in human terms the incredible effort it has cost me to write even this silly little note. And now the rain. Let it come. The wind is rising too, both on the ocean and in the stomach.
You could see the seething intensity of the man under certain circumstances when he wanted to say something or write something and he couldn't get anything out. He could neither say it nor write it. He wanted once to inscribe a book to me, I remember, when he was under the weather, and he just couldn't get his name down. And he was absolutely rigid with fury at himself. And I think it was always at himself.
In the spring of 1955, he returned at last to England. Much of his time was spent in mental hospitals. There was some question of a lobotomy, which would remove part of his brain and reduce him to a vegetable, but this was stopped. All he had was an operation for piles, and he was occasionally well enough to join his old friend Bob Pocock, a radio producer, in a nearby pub.
And suddenly he said, cut across my conversation, he said, you've changed, you know, you've changed. I said, good God, Malcolm, I said, 21 years. I said, a lot's happened in that time, you know. And he said, no, you've changed, you've changed. And it became progressively unhappier and unhappier. And so he said, oh, well, I suppose I'd better go. And he was clutching this copy, this battered copy of Under the Volcano and showing it to the landlady, who couldn't have known A from Z.
A distinguished psychiatrist, Dr. Michael Raymond, made a last attempt to stop his drinking.
Well, in those days, it was based entirely on Pavlovian principles, namely that with very strict regard to timing, one gave an injection of apomorphine, which one knew perfectly well would produce nausea and vomiting in about 10 minutes, but it varied with the individual. Having done that and having determined what was the nausea time, one then gave alcohol just before the nausea ensued. And without any doubt at all, it's relatively easy to produce a conditioned aversion to alcohol.
Night. And once again, the nightly grapple with death. The room shaking with demonic orchestras, the snatches of fearful sleep, the voices outside the window, my name being continually repeated with scorn by imaginary parties arriving, the darks, spinets. As if there were not enough real noises in these nights, the color of gray hair, not like the rending tumult of American cities, the noise of the unbandaging of great giants in agony, but the howling pariah dogs, the cocks that herald dawn all night, the drumming, the moaning. He distinguished an incredibly filthy man sitting hunched in the corner on a lavatory seat, so short his trousered feet didn't reach the littered, befouled floor. You like Maria? This man croaked again. I send, mi amigo. He farted. Que hora? Asked the consul, shivering, noticing in the runnel a dead scorpion. What's the time? Sick, answered the man. No, it's half past six by the clock. You mean half past six by the clock? Si, senor, half past six by the clock. Insect world had somehow moved nearer and now was closing, rushing in upon him, a kind of seething from which, as from the persistent rolling of drums heard by some great dying monarch, occasionally a half-recognizable voice disassociated itself.
He had the most enormous megacolon, the lower part of our absolutely. Because of this, he had a horror of stinking. During this aversion treatment, which incidentally was only part of the treatment and a fairly minor part of his treatment at Atkins and Morris, but during this treatment, we used in those days to withhold fluid. The only fluid that the patients had was alcohol. And during a lull or at the end of one of these sessions, he was taken some milk,
Now, he was very thirsty, but he first used the milk to scrub his fingernails and wash his hands, and then he drank. This was perhaps bravado.
The Farolito, he said to himself. The lighthouse. The lighthouse that invites the storm and lights it. It was a strange place. A place really of the late night and early dawn, which as a rule did not open until 4 o'clock in the morning, but today being the holiday for the dead, it would not close. The proprietor, Ramon Diosdado, known as the Elephant, who was reputed to have murdered his wife to cure her neurasthenia, the beggars, hacked by war and covered with sores, one of whom, one night after 4 drinks from the consul, had taken him for the Christ.
The consul, that creature of Malcolm Lowry's, spent his last night on Earth in the Farolito. There he found himself surrounded by a group of irritated bureaucrats. This did not surprise the consul, as he had always considered himself the chief of sinners.
Then Sinabria spoke for the first time. "I'm afraid you must come to prison," he said simply in English. The chief of municipality rolled his hips and gripped the consul's arm. "You Al Capone. You a Jew, Chingao. We have found out on the telephone. Is it right that you are a criminal? You want to be a policeman? I make you policeman in Mexico." The chief of rostrums took him by the coat. Someone else seized him from behind. In spite of his struggles, he was being dragged towards the door. The chief of rostrums was looking down at him. "Norte Americano, eh?" said the chief. "Inglés, you Jew." He narrowed his eyes. The consul, shaking himself free, tore frantically at the horse's bridle. The chief of rostrums stepped aside, hand on his holster. He drew his pistol. With his free hand, he waved away some tentative onlookers. "I blow you wide open from your knees up, you cabron," he said, "you pelado." "No, I wouldn't do that," said the consul quietly, turning around. "That's a Colt 17, isn't it? It throws a lot of steel shavings." The chief of rostrums pushed the consul back out of the light, took 2 steps forward, and fired. Lightning flashed like an inchworm going down the sky, and the consul, reeling, saw above him for a moment the shape of Popocatapetl, plumed with emerald snow and drenched with brilliance. The chief fired twice more, the shots spaced, deliberate. Thunderclaps crashed on the mountains and then at hand. Released, the horse reared, tossing its head. It wheeled round and plunged, neighing, into the forest. At first, the consul felt a queer relief. Now he realized he had been shot. He fell on one knee, then with a groan, flat on his face in the grass. "Christ," he remarked, puzzled. "This is a dingy way to die." A bell spoke out. "Dolente, dolore." It was raining softly. Shapes hovered by him, holding his hand, perhaps still trying to pick his pockets, or to help, or merely curious. He could feel life slivering out of him like liver, ebbing into the tenderness of the grass. He was alone. Where was everybody? Or had there been no one? Suddenly, he screamed. And it was as though this scream were being tossed from one tree to another as its echoes returned. Then, as though the trees themselves were crowding nearer, huddled together, closing over him, pitying, somebody threw a dead dog after him down the ravine.
The village of Ripe, in the south of England. It was here that Lowry and his wife settled in final refuge.
The house was built in 1740. Marjorie is having a wonderful time with the garden, as am I. She planting seeds destined to be glowing hollyhocks. I sowing sweet peas, 4 seeds in each hole, 1 for the rabbit, 1 for the cow, 1 for the field mouse, and 1 to grow, as they say here. While meanwhile, I weed sentences full of contorted lousewood, which I lay neatly in rows for use later, no doubt.
He was writing again, rallying whatever forces remained in the full knowledge that after the volcano, there might be nothing. His landlady and neighbor was Mrs. Winnie Mason.
Used to sit like that, gazing into space. He did a lot of that. Very often you felt he was looking through you. He was looking to something beyond. He knew there was something beyond, if only he could reach it, if only he could attain it. Well, I don't know. No, don't bother. I should have called him a great gentleman to us.
He drank little now. He would go with Marjorie to Charlie Baker's pub and have a pint of bitter and walk home.
Oh, yes, and he was always standing in the hedgerows. We used to have a hollow tree in Ripe, and he'd stand in there for hours. And he would hang around the churchyard. And he always had a grin, which everybody thought he was a little bit, not quite all there sometimes. I used to wonder what he was up to.
Stood in the hedgerow grinning away at
him. Yes, I used to wonder. He would grin if anyone came by. He wasn't a man to talk a lot.
No, he'd start you off, you see. He'd ask you something, you know. And then he'd start you off and he would say, let's see what we get. Yeah.
He was a good listener.
Oh, yeah, terrific listener. No wonder he was a good book writer, I should think. All good listeners are good book writers.
He took Marjorie to the Lake District, not because it was a land of Wordsworth, but because it reminded him of British Columbia, where he had once been a good book writer.
Dear Harvey, I'm writing without my glasses, so the contours of this note may be a little awry. Also, I am very tired. I cannot believe our poor pier has been swept away. That pier that gave so much happiness to many and us, was us in a sense. We risked our lives building it. Nobody could understand how it survived so long, not even engineers. And it was nicknamed the Crazy Wonder on the beach. Ramshackle from certain angles though it was, and the handrails puerile. But oh, the washing hung out there on the line, like great white stationary birds beating their wings against the gale. Margie and I built it together with practically no tools. And I'm broken-hearted it is gone.
Shortly before 7 o'clock on the 27th of June, 1957, Mr. and Mrs. Malcolm Lowry walked from the Yew Tree Pub to the White Cottage at Ripe, carrying a bottle of gin.
Towards evening, it was in the bedroom anyhow. He had more than sufficient, and she took the bottle of gin away from him and dashed it against the wall, the far side of the bed. There was the mark for a long time till they had it repapered.
and he went for her with a chair. And she came in to me, and she said, "Oh, Winnie, Winnie isn't my real name, it's only my pet name. Oh, Winnie, I'm so frightened. Malcolm's had some gin. Could I sleep in here with you tonight?"
Sometime during the night, Malcolm Lowry, having consumed a half bottle of gin, ate a few morsels of food, and swallowed two bottles of barbiturate sleeping pills.
I don't think she slept much all night, neither did I. And then she dressed and she said, "Well, I suppose I must go get poor old Malk a cup of tea." And she went in, came back very hurriedly. "Winnie, he's gone." And I said, "What, up to Liverpool?" Because that was the last thing she... "No," she said, "he's dead."
My secrets are of the grave and must be kept. And this is how I sometimes think of myself, as a great explorer who has discovered some extraordinary land from which he can never return to give his knowledge to the world. But the name of this land is Hell. It is not Mexico, of course, but in the heart.